One of the things I enjoy the most when I travel in eastern North Carolina is riding on the ferries. Have you ever wondered what it takes to keep the ferries maintained and looking great? It's a big job. And this week we're going to visit with the people who undertake this important task and go to the facility where the work is done, the North Carolina State Shipyard at Mann's Harbor.
We're visiting now with Mr. Don Chapman. And Don is the Assistant Director of Ferry Maintenance and Materials for the state of North Carolina. And Don, I understand in the past 10 years since you took over here, the job has gotten bigger, keeping our ferries looking good and running properly, but you've been able to do it and do it even better, more efficiently.
Well, we've been able to achieve a lot of things in that 10 years. And it's very difficult to say where the beginning was because sometimes we still feel as we're at the beginning. But when we first came here, we had 101 employees. We've since reduced that to numbers to where we have approximately staff of 72. And we've risen in the way of productivity from around 35% to our current 76% productivity factor, which allows us to actually do more with less. However, I might say that the people that we're doing it with less have great attitudes, and they're really the people that make it happen.
How many ferries do you maintain in the North Carolina system?
Well, at this time we have 23 ferries. In total we have 31 pieces of equipment. That includes tugs, dredges, and barges.
Not only are you maintaining them, but I understand you're even modifying some now so they can carry more load.
The management of the ferry division has basically given us the opportunity to and the challenge to see what we could do. Consequently, we were able to undertake the complete renovation of the motor vessel Carteret, which was to extend it by 60 feet, making her total length 220. We completely repowered it. We redid its entire superstructure, and for approximately $3 million. Outside, it was stated that, the state auditors came in and reviewed it and felt that it was justified that we had saved the state $661,000.
Wow. And I understand they recognize you and your men for that accomplishment.
They did, and very nicely and justly. They presented us with this continuous progress improvement award for the most dollars saved for that physical year. And I think the thing that I'm most happy about is that our people met the actual delivery date, which is a very unusual event in any kind of construction.
Shipyard Superintendent Jimmy Twitty described the type of work they do on the ferries.
It ranges from sandblasting, which we do very little of now, but we do it, and ultra-high pressure washing to remove paint, welding. We rebuild engines, transmissions here, painting of all types. We have our own machine shop. We build our own shafts. It's just numerous things. Anything that involves a vessel, we do it here. The only thing that we don't do is our own propellers. Other than that, if it's on the vessel, we repair it.
And we speak of vessels. We started off by talking about the ferries when we began the program. So you bring the ferries in regularly for that?
Yes, they're on a schedule, a shipyard schedule that's created through the people here, management, and Morehead City, which is our headquarters. We're mandated by Coast Guard on several of our vessels. They have to be hauled out twice in 5 years, not to exceed 30 months. The other vessels, we routinely haul them out every other year.
Coming up, Locke Wings will take us on a tour of the shipyard and introduce us to some of the fine people working there.
Ken, let's just come on through here and we'll take a look at the parts warehouse here. This is where we keep all of our supplies, spare engines. This is where shipping and receiving is.
You have so many parts here. I'm assuming that sometimes things go bad on the ferries or fail. At times when you don't want to bring the ferry in, can you dispatch a crew out to make the repair?
Almost always. When these vessels are on run, and particularly during the tourist season, we do everything possible to keep from breaking these scheduled runs. So if we have a magnetic compass that becomes no longer calibrated, we'll dispatch that contractor to take care of it. If it's an electronic compass, we've got our own electronics people. Anything mechanical, we dispatch our technicians from up here at this facility. And regarding any other emergencies, we have field maintenance crews on the other terminals that take care of that sort of thing in the field. Any emergency like that, we do everything possible not to break that run, not to bring the vessel into this yard.
It looks like you have literally millions of dollars of parts in this room.
You name it. There's not anything that could go wrong on these vessels that's not in inventory here, hopefully. Ken, I'll tell you, this facility is completely self-sufficient. What we have over here in this building right here are large generating units. And in the event the local utility fails or power goes out, these generating units right here will generate all the electricity we need to entirely run this facility.
Locke, it looks like with all this equipment, there must be a tremendous investment here.
Yeah, I'll tell you, if you had to go out and buy all this equipment, it really would be. We've been utilizing the federal surplus program, and that is the federal government getting rid of any equipment that the armed services or any of their other branches no longer use. And we've acquired all this crane equipment right here through federal surplus. And with the budgetary constraints that we've got in this state now, it's not costing the taxpayers anything other than maintenance on this equipment. And then here is our fabrication shop. And again, most of the equipment in there has been acquired through federal surplus. And it's just been quite an accomplishment to get all this together with really very little budgetary resources.
Locke, you called this a fabrication shop. What do you make in here?
This is our steel fabrication shop. And we've got large cutoff machines, brakes for bending and forming steel, rollers for making radius. We've got cutoff saws. So any foundation, cover, any prefabricated part that we'll use on board the vessels in the systems is pre-made in this shop, and there's several advantages to it. One, you can do it very accurately. Secondly, they are fabricated out of the weather, and we can continue to progress with that phase of the operation, even in inclement weather.
Locke, it looks a little bit like a ferry, but I know that's not what this is.
No, that's far from. This is actually a Marine Fisheries Division vessel.
What type of work are you doing to the vessel?
This particular vessel is a fairly old landing barge. It's an LCU. So as it comes in, there's regular maintenance items. We check the shafts, the rudders, anything else that the crew has requested. In addition, being the age that it is, we're gauging the bottom for a deteriorated shell plate to be certain they don't get out there and all of a sudden have a large hole in the boat. In addition, there's a lot of waste on the bulwarks, which are the side walls on this vessel. We've cut those off, and we're going to replace it with a new configuration. And again, there's such heavy loads on this particular vessel that was never intended for, we're doing a deck over because the weight and the scope of work has fatigued that deck so badly, we're going to just restore it by sheeting over the entire deck area.
I see the ferry, but how did you get it there?
Well, I'll tell you, it's a good question, Ken. It's the system here in front of us, this large pit in front of us, is part of a system called the synchro lift. And it's a method for raising, maneuvering, and placing these boats on the various production platens. This pit right here is part of the rail system for that. And you can see the vessel there is sitting on an arrangement of small cars, not unlike a small gauge rail car. And at that point, what we've done is we've blocked to accommodate the bottom contour of that vessel. And basically, we just slip those cars out here in the slip. We'll look at that in a few moments. Drop it down, the boat comes in, we pick it up and pull it back and put it wherever we need it. If you like, we can see our dock master shortly, and he can explain the system a little more in depth than I can.
It'd be great. I saw something that looked like that standing in the Alligator River near the bridge one day.
Yeah, that's a geo geological survey barge, and it's run by the equipment division. And again, as I mentioned with the marine fisheries, they're another division of state government that we're doing work for.
These are the same tracks that you'd use for a railway?
They're similar, different in size.
I can feel moisture blowing from somewhere.
Yeah, they're pressure washing that house right now, getting ready to spray it. And they'll be spraying it right after lunch.
This is the Governor Hunt. I've had a few rides on her. I think she runs up around Knott's Island.
Yeah, that's correct.
You're just about ready to put her over. What work have you done to it?
Well, this vessel's been in here about 4 weeks now, and a normal yard period for these particular vessels is 6 to 8 weeks. When it comes in, it's been out and on run for about 2.5 years. So when it comes in, as you can imagine, the bottom's got a little bit of work to be done to it. Our normal regimen, and we've got a standard set of specifications for these yard periods. When it comes in, we'll haul it up on the sinker lift and bring it back here to its platen. And the first thing we'll do is pressure wash the entire hull. Meanwhile, at the same time, the mechanics are pulling the shafts and rudders out of it, the props, checking all the external propulsion equipment on it. From then, after you've got it all pressure washed, our welding department and our hull shop will assess any structural damage or deterioration or maintenance that may be required. And during that process, our paint department is continuing their surface prep regimen. And basically that's sanding down any rust, chipping it off. We've got an ultra high pressure water blaster here that will actually remove these coatings to bare metal at 40,000 PSI. And so all that's kind of taking place simultaneously. It's clean paint and check for mechanical and structural soundness. Ken, these are the types of jigs that we used in the modification on the motor vessel Carteret. And I think Mr. Chapman mentioned earlier that that was a project in which we cut the boat in half, inserted a large 60-foot midbody, and then what we've got going here are the parts for the superstructure. And we use this so we can do large flat layouts for decks, for bulkheads, for roofs. These are wing walls for our new superstructure. And in addition, we used a jig like this to insert the midbody and add the two forward lounges on this vessel, which was another major modification that we did right here at this yard.
So this is the weld shop where you put it all together?
Pretty much. We do a lot of fabrication in here out of the weather. Again, this is similar to the fab shop we saw out in the yard. You can do a lot of construction in here out of inclement weather. We've got welding machines here. There's cutoff machines. There's rollers to handle long steel with. Right down here, Ken, we've got our pipe shop, and this is where we overhaul our C-valves, pipe up our venting, bilge piping, anything like that. And as you can see in here, you have these overhead cranes where we can move large parts, move large pieces of material around. And that's pretty much what takes place in this shop.
Now, apparently this is where you do your engine work.
Yeah, this is our engine rebuild shop. And right now, Ken's rebuilding this particular unit. Ken, what kind of engine have we got here?
It's a Caterpillar 3304.
Cat 3304?
3304. These are our generators. We use these on the motor vessel Hunt.
Right.
The various variants.
Some of the other things that we rebuild here are all the main engines out of the vessels, generator, power plants, chain falls. Our grid coolers come in here, and these guys test them, be sure that they're straight and ready to go back on the vessel. And all this type of work's done in-house and takes place right here.
And I can see that you also make the signs that are on the ferries.
Yeah, we do, Ken. And as you can tell, it's a very dangerous job.
Oh, yeah.
We actually do all the lettering for the vessels right here. And we do a lot of the regulatory placards, instructional advertising art. We've got ship stores and various terminals and onboard vessels where we sell souvenirs, and we've done a lot of point-of-purchase artwork for that as well.
This is Richard Dewhurst, and he is the supervisor of the machine shop. And I see some shafts for some of the ferries here. What are some of the other things you do here, Richard?
What we do is we repair our own shafts. We also fabricate our own shafts. And all the production work that's machine-wise is done in this shop throughout the whole ferry division. And right now we're finally getting caught up in our rebuilding of our propeller shafts that we went through during the winter time in our busy season. Other stuff that we do here is we make our own rudder shafts. We have several tender vessels such as tugboats and dredges, and any parts I need machining, we machine in the shop as well.
This is Dave Pruitt. Dave is in charge of the electrical shop, but he also has a very big responsibility as safety officer, is that right?
That's correct.
That must be a big job in a facility like this.
Well, yes. This is one of the highest accident occupations industries in the U.S., and with about 80 workers out there and a lot of heavy steel and the flames from the welding machines and the torches going, there's a lot of emphasis put on safety. That is a very big issue within the Ferry Division and North Carolina Department of Transportation. We conduct monthly safety audits, safety meetings, and we do everything we can to keep all of our people trained to the peak on their equipment and all the safety features of their equipment to prevent our accidents here.
When the big ferries and the other vessels are lifted out of the water and put back in the water, the man at the controls is Ray Brown. Ray, give us a little idea of what you do.
I'm the dock master here at the facility, and my job is to bring the boats out of the water safely and put them back in safely.
What does that involve?
Well, that involves blocking for each vessel. Each vessel is a little bit different. The blocking configuration will be a little bit different. Maneuvering the boats into this slip here, and this is the sinker lift, which is a suspended platform, and it lowers into the water.
So the next time you take a ride on one of North Carolina's ferries, you'll have a better idea of what it takes to keep them up and running. Hope you'll join us again next week for more people, places, and things from the Outer Banks in northeastern North Carolina. I'm Ken Mann. Thank you for watching, and may God bless you richly. My heart.